International proudly presents a ministry of Dream Life Church International. Welcome to the Reformer's Life broadcast, where Dr. John A. Tashola is the senior minister. Today you are going to be tremendously blessed and imparted by the word of the Lord, and the Spirit of God is going to expose you to higher levels of living, and your life will never be the same again. So prepare your heart now and expect from the Lord as we go into the message already in progress.
Hi, and God bless you. Welcome to the Reformers Life TV broadcast. My name is Cherie Wilson, and I'm one of the pastors here at Dream Life Church International. As always, it is my expectation that the Spirit of the Lord is going to enrichly impart and bless you tonight, because that's basically what He does. He makes the Word alive. But before we jump into the reason for why we are here, which is the Word of God itself, I just want to take an opportunity to always welcome you, to let you know that we appreciate you, all of our network partners, network churches, network leaders, all of you from all over the world, no matter where you are, we appreciate your support then, your support now, and your continued support in the future. It is truly appreciated, so God bless you. Also, reaching out once again to our very own Dream Life Church family, God bless you, Dream Life, whether in-house and home, whatever it may be, we love you and we appreciate your continued dedication and support and all of your encouraging words on streaming right there online. So do know that we recognize you. Now, as I said before, it is my expectation that the Spirit of the Lord is going to minister, because that is what He does. And in process of that, as we are preparing our hearts and our minds, let's place a demand on the Spirit of God together, because He is the one who makes the Word of God alive. And as you're doing that, which means we're partnering up our expectation together, I want you to go ahead and build on that expectation. What do I mean? Continue to reach out to someone, encourage them, let them know that the Reformers Life TV broadcast is on the air and that they don't want to miss what God has to say. So make that quick call, that quick text, maybe start that watch party so they get that personal notification that, hey, they're on. Let me get online to hear what they have to say. Now, if you're believing that with me, you're ready for the impact of God's word, I want you to open up your word with me to Philippians chapter 2. Philippians chapter 2. And as you're doing that, I just want to kind of give you a rehearsal of what we've done progressively with God so far. For the past couple of weeks, we've been talking about a new series, The Renovation of the Mind. Every time I think about that, it just does something to me, because to know that our minds can be renovated is a powerful thing indeed. And we learned about this as we started off in our series, dealing with the very first part of our topic. We begin to deal with why our minds need to be renovated. We begin to talk about how we want to institute change. I'm talking about real life change, not just change in my circumstances, but when my life is changed as a result of my mind being changed with God for the better. And the Holy Spirit began to let us know that that kind of change can be established, but it comes by partnering with Him in the renovation of our mind. And so He took us to Romans 12, verse 1 and 2, and He focused mainly on verse 2, where it says to renewing of our mind. That is, in essence, where He's talking about that renovation process. And that was the very first part of our teaching, renovations in progress. And that is an encouragement, people of God, because as we partner with the Holy Spirit, as we use the transformative power of the Word of God, not just reading it, not just studying it, but applying it, walking it out daily, guess what? You and I are a renovation in progress. And then we talked about last week, always thinking about how God so loves us because He makes us aware of those things that we need to know. It makes me think of the Word of God that says that He knows what we have need of even before we ask it. And He began to share with us to pay pay attention to the conversations and the thoughts that we entertain. Because we are talking about in the second part of our series, the building code of the mind of Christ, and how we cannot allow ourselves to entertain every thought and every conversation. Because guess what? Conversations access your spirit. They are purposed to access you, to access your mind, to see if I can get a way in. Even thinking about it, when God conversates with us, guess what he's doing? He's accessing our spirit. And so we want to make sure that we are guarding our mind. We're guarding our heart with all diligence, taking every thought and every conversation to the Holy Spirit, the foreman on the scene, the landlord of our home, and making sure it lines up with the building code of the mind of God. And then he began to show us how he even conforms us by showing us some of the materials that he used out of the word in Philippians 4 and 8. To know that God looks at the word of God even as a form of material for building his own home in us. That is an awesome thing. And so we looked at that because the word of God tells us to ponder, to think upon these things. So there was a lot that was said on last week, and you already know if you've been with us for some time, we've always got to press forward because there's a lot I want to share. But if you want to hear those teachings in its entirety, you can simply go to our channel on YouTube. It's Dream Life Church International, and you can listen to every teaching as much as you want, as much as you deem necessary. But tonight, we're going to round out this series. We're going to deal with the third and final part of our series tonight, and I'm kind of excited about it because this is something I believe that is a desire of every last believer in the body of Christ, and that is titled Being Like-Minded. Being like-minded. Now, I asked you earlier to turn with me to Philippians chapter 2, and we're going to start reading at verse 19 and go a little further, okay? I'm going to be reading out of the New King James Version, and that's Philippians chapter 2. We're going to read verses 19 to 21, and it reads, "But I trust in the Lord Jesus to send Timothy to you shortly." This is Apostle Paul. "That I also may be encouraged when I know your state. For I have no one like-minded who will sincerely care for your state. For all seek their own, not the things which are of Christ Jesus." Now, we're talking about being like-minded, and I'm sure that you and I, all of us together, we're wanting to be like-minded like Jesus Christ. That is really, when we're thinking about this series overall, this is actually the work of the Holy Spirit. He's looking to make us be more Christ-like, where you and I really come into compliance. We really look like the new life in Christ Jesus that we have now obtained. And when we're talking about being like-minded, we're talking about having the equal quality and inclinations of Jesus Christ. But it has so much more to it than that. And we're going to just kind of dig a little deeper, really define what these things are. Because as I was going through this teaching with the Holy Spirit, I myself discovered something new for me. I don't know if it's new for you, but it was new for me. And it really made me ponder and think about some things. But let's look at what it means to be like-minded as Christ. What is that? Now, we have two definitions we're going to know and learn for tonight. But the first is, when we're talking about being like-minded as Christ, is to have the same quality of thinking as Christ. The same quality of thinking as Christ. What does that mean? That means that the way Christ thinks, literally, not figuratively, literally, is the way you and I think. That means what God likes is what I like. What God dislikes is what I dislike. What God loves is what I love, and what he hates is what I hate. One of the things he and I were talking about is how he is a lover of truth. So to mean to be Christ-like, like-minded like God, it means that we just don't entertain empty thoughts. We don't just entertain conversations that have no real value, that have no truth of God's word reflected within it. So we are lovers of truth when we are Christ-like or like-minded as him. Another definition is, it also means to be of the same inclination, in which you naturally and sincerely
care for what God cares for. You naturally and sincerely care for what God cares for. What does that mean? That means that whatever is entrusted into our hands by Father God, we care for it the same way that God would care for it. Whether it's an assignment, whether it's a goal, whether it's something that God is prompting us to do for someone, even if it means spending time with someone, we are handling it exactly in the same likeness, mindset, attitude, and definition of care that Christ himself would do. This is literally what Paul was trying to advise the church of Philippi when he was saying, I'm sending my son in the gospel to you, one who is like-minded like me. To simplify what he was saying, he said, it may not physically be me, but it's me. It's just me in another form. It's me in another personality. But Timothy, my son that I'm sending to you, is one who has a mind just like me, one that is passionate about the word, one that will naturally care for your state. The way I would entreat you is the way he's going to entreat you. The way I would speak to you is the way he's going to speak to you. Literally, he is me coming to you. And so this is what God wants for us, because I was thinking about it with him. Wouldn't it be something if everything God gives us to do, we handle it just like God? Can you imagine what that would be like? That every assignment, every goal, every plan, every purpose, that literally I'm handling it no differently than God himself. That's why Christ was always saying to people, when you see me, you see the Father. The same mind that my Father has is the same mind I've exposed to you. The same generosity, the same entreating, the same love, the same care, the same passion. It is no difference between me and my Father. Literally, we are one, not just by way of me being his son, but I've got the mind of my Father. And literally, people of God, this is what God wants of us, to literally have his mind in every single thing that we do. And guess what? We have the ability to do that, because when he was talking to me about this, he kept reminding me, and I know we've rehearsed this in the first part and the second part, but it deems and it's necessary to be said. You have the mind of Christ, but it does not mean you think like God. You can have the mind of Christ. We have a regenerated spirit, yes. We have access to the mind of Christ by way of the Holy Ghost who dwells on the inside of us. But you can have the mind, but don't have the thinking. And that's why the renovation process is necessary. Because after we come out of the darkness, being translated from the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of light, it doesn't mean that automatically everything changed about you. Your position changed, but not the way you live your life changed. You have to be taught that. You have to be instructed in that. You have to be made aware of what changes are deemed necessary by the Holy Ghost. And so he wanted us to know that it's not just enough for you to have the mind of Christ. The renovation process is to get you to live, to think, and to have the inclinations, the purposes, and thoughts of Jesus Christ himself. So we don't want to just have a mind. I want to be like-minded like God. I want you to say that I want to be like-minded as Christ. I want to be like-minded as Christ. Because the thing about it is, when we were talking about it, I hear you, Father. He said a mind is a terrible thing to waste, especially when you got access to the mind of supremacy, the mind of all minds, the one who is omnipresent and omni-known. He said it's a shame that you got access to this, but you refuse to come into conformity, because to conform to something means that you come into an area of agreement. You comply with what is deemed necessary by way of the Holy Ghost. But you and I, our mind in Christ goes to waste when I don't allow my mind to be renovated where I am Christ-like, meaning my mind is like his. So we want to make sure that we are not just having the mind of Christ. It's good that you got it. But ask yourself the question, do I really think like God? Do I really think like him? Because that's the question that he's been asking me, and it's been real personable. Do you really think like me in this area of your life and in that area of your life? And to be honestly with him, and I'll be honest with you because it's a moment of transparency, no, I don't. So there is need for renovation in my life, and you submit to the process to get to be like-minded. So as we were talking about this, he began to say to me, a bigger part of why the Holy Spirit does the work that he does. It is to get us to be like-minded, but he says, Cherie, it's also to cause your value system to change. Do you know that every mind, it's only two, it's the mind of Christ and it's the carnal mindset. Did you know that each mindset has a personal value system? It has a value system. And the value systems are very, very different. They're polar opposites. Let's look at, first of all, what a value system is. What is a value system? A value system is defined, and it's a little long, so I'll repeat it for you. A value system is defined as a set of principles, fundamental truths that establish the foundation, of one's core beliefs, and ideas, that shape their behavior, character, and standard, which is shown in a person's decisions and choices. I'm gonna say that for you one more time. A value system is defined as a set of principles, fundamental truths that establish the foundation of one's core belief and ideas that shape your behavior, character, standard, which is shown in a person's decisions and choices. One of the things he began to share with me about this, because we're talking about the mind of Christ and we're talking about the carnal mind and we're dealing with their two value systems. That's why the renovation process is necessary, because when you are in the kingdom of darkness, you have a carnal mind. You have a value system of a carnal minded person. But now when you are translated into the kingdom of our dear son, the kingdom of light, the Holy Spirit is like he said in the very first part of our series, the first work he starts doing is, I've got to renovate your mind, because your mindset has to change, but also your value system has to change. And when he was saying this to me, he said, do you know that when you are in circumstances and situations, he says, how you react, how you respond, whether a person realizes this or not, because he said, I'm always watching and I'm always knowing. He said, it tells you, and he says, you know, because it gets on your radar whether you are carnally minded in this area or whether you are spiritually minded in this area. The thing about it is, it's one or the other mindset that is dominating. It's no in between. You are either carnally minded in an area or you are either spiritually minded in an area. And where we are carnally minded, that is the area that has to be renovated. Because these things are the carnal mind is in enmity against God. It cannot do the things of God. Do you get why it has to be renovated? One of the things that we were talking about when we're dealing with these value systems, the value system of the mind of God or the mind of Christ and the value system of the carnal mind, is that they have two very different focal points. Let's go ahead and just read something very quickly. Turn with me to Romans chapter 5, chapter 8. Romans chapter 8. We're going to read the same scripture, but in two different translations. Romans chapter 8, verse 5. And we're going to read it from the Amplified Classic Translation. And we're going to read it from the Contemporary English Version. Now, in the Amplified Classic Version, it reads, for those who are according to the flesh and are controlled, meaning dominated by the unholy desire, set their mind and their pursuit and their, on and pursue those things which gratify, which mean are pleasing to and satisfactory to the flesh. But those who are according to the Spirit and are controlled by the desires of the Spirit set their mind on and seek those things which are gratifying, or gratify who? The Holy Spirit, which mean pleasing and satisfactory to him. Now, in the Contemporary English Version, it reads, people who are ruled by their desires think only of themselves. Everyone who is ruled by the Holy Spirit thinks about spiritual things. When we're talking about a value system of the mind of Christ and of the carnal mind, each and every one of them has a center and a focus. The mind of Christ is one that is God-centered. It is God-centered. It seeks to gratify God, and it seeks to fulfill the desires of God's heart. That is the mind of Christ's value center. That is his value. His value is all based upon that. That is the value system. Now, the carnal mind has a completely different value system. The center point or the center focus of a carnal mind's value system is about self. It is self-centered. It is self-seeking and self-gratifying. That is its purpose. Do you know when the Bible says that its mind, this mind cannot do the things of God, nor is it able to even submit to the will of God? It's because God is not a part of its value system. In the carnal mind, God is not a part of the value system. Self is God. Self is God, not God himself. So when it comes time to do what God wants you to do, if your mind has not been renovated in that area and the dominant mindset is that of a carnal mind, you're going to have difficulty trying to submit to the will of God because God is not God in that area. You are God still. You are the one. Self is still dominating. Self is still in control. And self-value system is what is being accomplished. So we want to make sure this is why we're talking about being like-minded. When you look at Jesus Christ, just thinking about some of the things he always conferred. My will is to do the will of the one who sent me. I, in of myself, I can absolutely do nothing except that which I have heard or seen of my Father. Now you got to think about that. Christ is not saying that he can't do nothing. He can do something. The thing is, he's choosing not to do anything without the approval, without the witness, without the leading and the guiding of God. Why? Because the mindset of Christ is God-centered. It's all about God. It's about fulfilling God's will, God's heart, God's desire. Christ, as the Son of God, he sought after fulfilling the will of God in his life. And so he had a different value system than the value system of the flesh. So even when we're talking about this, let's go ahead and look at some of the values that make up the value system of the mind of Christ. What are some of these values that we're talking about? The value system of the mind of Christ. The first value is that it is a mindset that values discipline. It is a mindset that values discipline. We're going to read for a little bit. Let's go to verse 10 to 16. Philippians chapter 3, verse 10 to 16. And we're going to read from the Amplified Classic Translation. And I'm going to read from verse 10. And it says, "For my determined purpose is that I may know him, that I might progressively become more deeply and intimately acquainted with him, perceiving and recognizing and understanding the wonders of his person more strongly and more clearly, that I may in the same way come to know the power overflowing from his resurrection, which it exerts over believers, and that I may so share his sufferings as to be continually transformed, renewed, and renovated in spirit, in his likeness, even to his death in hope. That if possible, I may attain to the spiritual and moral resurrection that lifts me up from among the dead, even while in the body. Not that I have now attained this ideal or have already been made perfect, but I press on to lay hold of, grasp, and make my own for that which Christ Jesus, the Messiah, has laid hold of me to make me his own." He's saying my goal and my purpose, my determination is to literally fulfill the reason why God has called me, why God has chosen me, the reason he literally made me his own. This is Paul speaking here. Verse 13, "I do not consider, brethren, that I have captured and made it my own yet." And I love how he said yet. But one thing I do, and it is my aspiration, forgetting what lies behind me and straining forward to what lies ahead. I got to stop there for a second, because every time I read this, it's almost like I see Apostle Paul's mind through the eyes of the Holy Spirit. We know that he had a history of being a murderer of the Jews. You know, I believe that there were times that Apostle Paul went into places being led of the Holy Ghost, being led by the Spirit of God, and he went in being amongst the brethren, being amongst those, but there was always one or two voices that reminded him of who he used to be. And Paul had to get to the place where he had to strain past the thoughts, the conversations, the whisperings in the crowd. How dare he think he can come and prophesy and teach and speak and give the gospel of God? You murdered Jews back in your day, but Paul had to press past the past of himself. He had to go into another place. He had to remind himself, this is my goal. This is my attain. I don't care about the conversation. It's like I literally can see him standing and ministering and preaching, and there are people gawking and people who are trying to bring division in the crowd, always remembering him about who he was and what he did. And I feel the Holy Spirit is saying this for a reason. It doesn't matter your past, because the Bible says you are a new creature in Christ Jesus. There will be those that the devil will use to instigate you, to try to make you think that you're the same one, the same person yesterday. But God wants you to know you are a new creature in Christ Jesus. He said all you have to do is remain in your renovation process, because that's what Paul said. He said, I'm going to lay hold to the purpose and the reason for why God chose me. That's a part of being like-minded. It doesn't matter, because many people tried to disqualify Jesus. Do you know that? The Bible said that he was as a prophet without honor in his own country. All they saw was the son of Mary and Joseph, but they never saw who he really was. So he had to press past some things. He had to continue to lay hold and have that mind that is advancing and progressing forward. Let's read a little bit more. He says, forward to what lies ahead. I press on forward the goal to win the supreme and heavenly prize to which God in Christ Jesus is calling me upward. So let those of us who are spiritually mature, full, have this mind and hold these convictions. And if any respect you have a different attitude of mind, God will make that clear to you also. Only let us hold true to what have been attained and walk and order our lives by that. One of the reasons why he said is that this is a mindset that loves discipline. Do you know that goals, when you are really committed to a goal, Apostle Paul was committed to a goal. Jesus was committed to a goal. When you're really committed to a goal, do you know that it actually helps you to create the discipline needed to attain that goal? When you have a goal, I mean a sincere goal in your mind and in your heart, and you're legitimately, I'm talking about legitimately, you're committed to it, it causes you to create a discipline to attain what you're looking to attain. People who have no goals, that's the reason why you ain't got no discipline. If you are a person who lacks goals in your life, you lack discipline because you have no goals. Goals institute discipline. When you think about it in the natural, he was reminding me, he said, Cherie, why do you think athletes, do you think that they actually enjoy the rigor that they go through, the regiment they have to undertake, the diet that they have to go on, the things that they do? Do you think they actually enjoy that? I said, no. He said, no, they don't. But the thing about it is they understand, if I'm going to get the prize, I've got to have a discipline. And so what they do, they willingly submit themselves under the rule of a discipline because their eye is on the goal. See, this is the thing. When your value system is of the mind of Christ and is God-centered, you don't make excuses. You institute disciplines to do what God has given you to do. The first word out of your mouth is, I don't feel like doing. No. When you are God-centered, that's why he said, I got to deal with your value system. Because if your value system is carnally minded, you don't have this kind of thought process. You don't have this kind of reasoning. You don't have these things that influence your decisions and your choices. But when you are striving with the Holy Ghost to be like-minded like Christ, because Jesus didn't make excuses for the will of God. The Bible says that he learned obedience. Through his suffering, he did what was necessary. He didn't give Father God excuses. He instilled the discipline needed to do what was required. So goals that you are committed to will help you to acquire and place upon yourself. And like he said, he don't even have to ask you to do it. The Holy Spirit said, I don't even have to make a recommendation to you. Can I recommend you do this? Can I? No. He said, you willingly, you begin to do things that you know are going to be a requirement to attain the goal of Christ. So this is a part of that mindset. It has a value for discipline. Another value is that this mindset has is that it values dependency. It values dependency. This is not the mind of one, as we know in the word of God that says in Proverbs, a man's ways in his own mind seems right. No. This is a mind that is dependent. I mean, seriously dependent upon the Holy Spirit, seriously dependent upon God himself. I don't want to make a decision without you, because the approval of God is a part of that value system. I want to know, God, what makes you happy? I want to know, God, what makes you proud? I want to know, God, what you approve of. I don't want to take a step without you. You know, in my devotion time with him, you know, I was just singing to him about some things. And sometimes God will sing to me and I'll sing back to him. But he says something to me and it made me just break down. He says, Cherie, you're not stepping behind me. You're not stepping aside of me. He said, literally, you're taking the same step with me. He said, we're taking steps together. And what he said is that should encourage you, because it means that you are doing things by my approval. See, this is the value system that God is talking about, what's in the mind of Christ. When I'm like-minded, like Jesus, it's nothing else matters. All I need to know is, God, do you approve? Do you approve? Do you approve? It doesn't matter who disapproves. It doesn't matter who says, no, you're in the wrong. As long as I know that God has founded my footsteps, because the word of God says, according to Psalms 119, his word is a lamp, hallelujah, to my feet and a light to my path. As long as I know that my footsteps, that nobody else understands why I'm taking them, is okay with God. That's all that matters to me. So this is a value system that values the approval of God. I want that dependency. And once again, looking at John 5 and 19, we talked about it a little bit. And it reads from the Amplified Classic. So Jesus answered them saying, I assure you most solemnly, I tell you the Son is able to do nothing of himself, of his own accord. That's my decision. I choose not to. But he is able to do only what he sees the Father doing. For whatever the Father does is what the Son does, and in the same way in his turn. Another thing about the value system of the mind of Christ is a value of humility. It is a mindset that values humility. I'm going to go ahead and read this for the sake of time, but I'm reading from Philippians chapter 2 once again, but I'm reading from verses 5 to 11, and I'm reading this out of the Amplified Classic. It says, let this same attitude and purpose and humble mind. I mean, think about that. God got a humble mind. God, he has a humble mind. Let it be in you, which is also in Christ Jesus. Let him be your example in humility, who, although being essentially one with God and in the form of God, possessing the fullness of attributes which make him God, God, did not think this equality with God was a thing to be eagerly grasped or retained, but rather stripped himself of all privileges and rightful dignity, as so to assume the guise of a servant slave, in that he became like men and was born in a human being. And after he had appeared in human form, he abased and humbled himself even still further. and carried his obedience to the extreme of death, even to the death of the cross. Therefore, because he stooped so low, humbling himself to the extreme, God has highly exalted him and has given him a freely bestowed upon him a name that is above every name. The reason we can use the name of Jesus is because Jesus stooped so low. He went abased. One of the things the Holy Spirit was reminding me of is that, Cherie, when Christ was tempted, he said there were moments that he was tempted to take up his glory. There were moments he was tempted to exercise his divinity. But he remained stooped. He remained low. And he said, because he did, he said, that's why there's power in that name. He said, do you know that humility can shut down anything that comes against you? He said, it's pride that brings the fall. But he said, when you are humble, he said, I'll exalt you. He said, I'll exalt you. And he said, what seems to be a place of impasse, what seems to be a lack of a breakthrough, he said, because you humbled yourself. You humbled yourself to the process. You humbled yourself to my instruction. You didn't try to take matters into your own hands. He said, I will exalt you and I'll catapult you forward. He said, but this comes through humility. I mean, you got to think about it. A God king left his throne, took on human flesh, and he submitted himself to his own creation. He submitted himself to every office of authority that he instituted. And I heard God said, even if the office was corrupt, he submitted. And I'll prove to you what he just said, because I heard somebody. He said, remember this. When it came time to pay taxes, he told Peter, although Jesus didn't believe in it, he said, I'm still a man submitted under authority. He said, because I'm an example to you. He said, give unto Caesar what's due Caesar. But he said, give unto God what's due God. He gave Caesar the coin, but he gave the submission and the humility to God. So he said, you got to learn how to give God what's due him. And he said, in humility, you learn how to give God what's due him. You give him what he wants. Because pride will say, self is what I want. Self get what. Remember, we're talking about value systems. The mind of Christ is willing, although being God, I will submit. Self won't submit, and it ain't even God. Self wants the accolades, the pats on the back, the recognition. But it's the spirit, the genuine spirit of God, the genuine spirit of humility that will allow you to be okay with being stooped so low. You know, even when we were talking about this, there's an example in the Word of God that I often would question him about. Why did Jesus stoop when the people brought the woman who was caught in adultery to him? I always ask him, why does the Bible make mention of that? You know, it's not there for no reason. Why did he stoop once and then twice? Because the one who could judge, the one who could did not. He extended his humility. He extended compassion. And he shut down all of the prideful ones in the pack. He said, if you are ever without sin, go ahead and cast the first stone. But they realized, I just sinned this morning. I just sinned yesterday, last week. They threw down their stones. Humility shut down pride. It shut down the boast of reasoning. See, this is why we're talking about this, because humility will cause you to be able to close the mouths of naysayers. But you got to be willing to not go as the Bible says. Don't take vengeance for yourself. Leave it to God. That's what real humility does. I don't have to defend myself. God is my defender. Another thing that this mindset values is that it values submission and obedience. And we just talked about that looking at Philippians chapter 2, verses 5 and 11 or through 11. Jesus obeyed God to the letter. That's amazing to me. There is no area of disobedience on the record of Jesus Christ. He literally did everything, thing that God wanted him to do. And he didn't just do it. He did it in a certain way, in a certain manner. He did it with the mind of Christ. He did it with the mind of his Father. He did it with the same care, the same quality, the same thinking, the same choices. He did it like his Father wanted. And this is what God is talking about. It's not about you just doing things, because sometimes, people of God, we can do things, but care is not there. We can do things, but passion is not there. We can do things. We're just doing it. And we're asking God to be satisfied with it. But even as I'm saying this, I'm hearing my mom. It didn't cost you nothing. It didn't cost you nothing. And see, this is the thing. We want the prize of being like Christ, but we don't want the opportunity to give the cost like Christ. To be like-minded like him, it cost Jesus something. But look at what all he accomplished. If you're willing to pay the price, because that's a part of this mind. I hear you, Holy Ghost. That's a part of this mindset. I'm willing to pay the piper. I'm willing to pay the debt. Because in Christ's obedience, he paid the debt for us. Isaiah 53 says that the chastisement of our peace was upon him, and that God was pleased to bruise him for us. Every iniquity, every sickness, every disease, every infirmity, everything he took upon himself, being sinless but becoming sin for us, he paid the debt. And that came by way of being willing to pay a cost for God. By having this mindset. See, when you get this mindset for real, that's why he said you could be carnal in one place, but have the spiritually minded in another place. He said you don't worry about the cost. It's reasonable service to you. You know, when we were talking about this, he said that's why, because I kept hearing, it don't take all that. It don't take all that. And I've heard that before, and I've heard that before, and I heard that before. But he gave me a different perspective. He said, what seems reasonable to you? The reason it seems extreme to another is because they got a carnal mind about it. The spiritual mind doesn't see a problem with it. Christ didn't have an issue with dying. He didn't have an issue with submitting himself to death. You got to think about this. God dying and submitting himself to death. He paid the cost for us. And it started way before the cross. Every day that Christ lived, it was a debt that was being paid. Every obedience he gave, it was a debt that was being paid. It started way before the cross. Because he had to be a sheep without spot or wrinkle. So he had to make sure the way he lived his life, that when it came time to make the sacrifice, it was the perfect sacrifice requirement. So we got to think about this, because another thing we're talking about and we're looking at this is that it is the mindset that seeks and values gratifying, pleasing, and fulfilling the desire of God. This is at the core of its belief, at the core of that value system. It's about God. It's not about me. It's about him. And I'm just going to give you this scripture so you can look at it, Romans 8 and 5 again from the Amplified Classic. But there's two more things I want to talk about as regards to this mindset in this value system. Another thing that this mindset values is it values compassion. It values compassion. And when I was talking to God about this, I feel him. He said that there needs to be a rekindling of compassion in the body of Christ. It's almost like we have become sterile in the place of compassion. Because one of the things he said about it, and I'm just going to read this for the sake of time. Let's go ahead and read Matthew 20, verse 29 to 34. And I'm reading this from the Amplified Translation, because this is a mindset that values compassion. From verse 29, it says, "And they were leaving Jericho. A large crowd followed him, and two blind men were sitting on the road. And when they heard that Jesus was passing by, they cried out, 'Lord, have mercy on us, son of David, Messiah.' The crowd sternly told them to be quiet, but they cried all the more, 'Lord, son of David, Messiah, have mercy on us.' Jesus stopped and called to them and said, 'What do you want me to do for you?' They answered him and said, Lord, we want our eyes to be open. And it says, he moved with compassion. Jesus touched their eyes, and immediately they regained their sight and followed him as his disciples. One of the things he was saying about compassion is that compassion is defined as the feeling or wanting to help someone. It is also a deep sympathy that is felt when confronted with another person's suffering or hurt. But he said this, you don't just feel what they feel, you're motivated to do something. You're motivated to act. He said that's what real compassion is. It's not enough to feel real compassion, real genuine compassion is, I feel what you feel, but I'm motivated to move and do something on your behalf. I don't leave you there. I don't leave you in that state. And when he was saying it to me, because, you know, this is a season of strong evangelism where God has given the body of Christ an open door, an open window to attain souls like never before. But he said the issue is that it's not that you don't have the words of life in your mouth. You don't have no compassion. You're not moved when you see the hungry. You're not moved when you see the lost. You're not moved when you see somebody striving to attain something. You're not moved when you see someone in their mind and they're sitting there and they're constrained and they're having issues. You're not moved. He said, where is the compassion? He said, this is what I mean to be like-minded. He said, because it's good you feel. It's good you deserve. But he said, where is the movement? He said, do you know that every move of God, we talk about Azusa Street, we talk about the move in the New Testament. He said, the underlying current behind what they did is because they had compassion. Compassion moves you to act. You don't just be satisfied with, she going through some issues in her mind. I'll just pray for her. No. God told you, don't just pray. He said, go over and talk to her. But you just want to pray. You don't want to do an action. And even sometimes praying is an action in our comfort. We don't want to step out. Jesus always stepped out, of course, in agreement to what Father God told him to do. There are some things, people of God, that we have to ask the Holy Spirit, where we have become sterile. I mean sterile. I smell it. Sterile in the place of compassion. Compassion is fragrant. But what I smell is like iron and clay. Have you ever gone into a medical institute or in a medical facility and all you smell is disinfectant? That's what I smell. He said, where is the fragrance of compassion? He said, that's why people throne Jesus, because he was known as a compassionate man. We want people to throne us, but we ain't got no compassion. He said, we got to get compassion back. And then the last thing that this mindset values is that it values forgiveness. It values forgiveness. Acts 7, 59 and 60, and I'm reading this from the Amplified Translation. They continued stoning Stephen, and he called unto the Lord and said, Lord Jesus, receive and accept and welcome my spirit. Then falling on his knees in worship while being stoned, he cried out loudly, Lord, do not hold this sin against them. Do not charge them. When he had said this, he fell asleep in death. I want to read to you what the Holy Spirit said. He was saying to me as I was looking at Stephen's response, because I couldn't help but remember the response of Jesus Christ on the cross. He had me to ponder on how both had cried out for the forgiveness of another. He said, Cherie, forgiveness is also looking out for another's interest. Forgiveness is also looking out for another's interest. This is where your attention is focused on someone else and not yourself, being more concerned about someone else's state than your own. Stephen and Jesus Christ, in the midst of agony and in the midst of death, they cried out on the account of their murderers. And they said, Father, hold it not to their charge. Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. In the midst, this is how you know you got the mind of Christ, because when he was talking to me about it, he brought me up this case, and I'm thinking of the woman's name. I think it was the Atkins family. This was happening in January of 2019. I'll never forget it. This woman's young son, who was about 17, was murdered by this other young boy. And they didn't know that she was a believer. When it came time to face the one who killed her son, she's crying and she's sobbing. But she said, I came here today with a purpose. She said, I made sure I came here with the right state of heart. She said, I forgive you for murdering my son. She said, because I'm thinking about this, you are the son of somebody else. You're somebody else's son. And she said, I pray for you as I pray for myself. And she said, even though I'm hurting, she said, it's not a bitterness for you. It's a bitterness against the enemy, because he is stealing two lives, not just one. And she said, if it's permitted, I want to hug you. Do you know why this woman is talking to the one that murdered her son? His defenses are breaking down. The whole time of the trial, he said nothing. His face was stone. It was like, I don't care what you throw at me. But the sentiment of this woman, the forgiveness of this woman, the compassion of this woman broke down the stoicness of him. And he said to her, forgive me. Forgive me. She was more determined to be aware of his interests. His interests over her own, being in pain, being in agony, asking God to help her to get over the process. But she made sure she took out the time to do God's will. She ministered to the one that murdered her son. This is why you got to have the mind of Christ. Because to do all that I'm talking about and to be like-minded, when we are really like-minded, you can do what we deem is impossible. See, we talk about impossibility when it comes to faith, but faith in the like-mindedness of Christ will allow you to do what man would say no man can do. You can show forth the evidence of Christ without even having to say a word. Your actions, your character, your standard, your behavior, it speaks volumes. It hushes the crowd. It gets people to ask you, who are you and where did you come from? And so tonight I want to pray for you. Because we've been talking about the renovation of our mind. And God has a purpose for tonight. And I want you to go ahead once again and put your hands on your head. And Father, even as we obey your instructions tonight, we are looking, Lord God, and we are in expectation for the continued progress and renovation of our mind. Father, we don't want to just have a mind of Christ. We want to be like-minded like you. We want the same intellect, the same thinking, the same purposes, the same intentions, the same behaviors, the same responses like you. We want to make those things that seem impossible with man be made known. It's possible with God when you become like-minded. And so, Holy Ghost, continue to do the renovation progress. Continue to do the process. Oh, in every area of our mind, reestablish compassion in every sterile place. Let the fragrance of compassion arise in the name of Jesus. Father, in every place of unforgiveness, bitterness, hurt, and resentment, Father, help us to let it go, for we will be more concerned with another than ourselves, and then we will demonstrate you, and we will be an open book, and we will show that this is the way and the key to salvation without even having to say a word, because my standard is Christ-like, my reflection is Christ-like, my speech is Christ-like. Christ-like. My behavior is Christ-like. And Father, I come against the assignment of mind-binding and mind-blinding spirits. I break that assignment in the name of Jesus. Even the spirit of mental psychosis in the name of Jesus Christ, even as the Holy Ghost is the one who raised Jesus from the dead, I decree and declare tonight he is regulating your mind. You are coming back to yourself in the name of Jesus Christ. Every case where you have been given up on, there is no distance in the spirit. But just like Eldab and Medab, I decree and declare that the spirit of God that rests upon me is going into you in the name of Jesus Christ. And that mind that is in Jesus Christ is coming alive in you. Father, I thank you for breakout. For breakout in the name of Jesus. We break the iron gate open. Your mind is no longer being regulated by fear, torment, despondency, depression, and fear. But now you have the mind of Christ. Father, I thank you. I thank you that just one touch is all it takes. One touch is all it takes from you. You said, I sent my word and you were healed. Now I command that word to fall on good ground in the mighty name of Jesus. And it shall bear forth the fruit of you in Jesus Christ's name. Hallelujah. I have no doubt that there was something that was said as the word of the Lord went forth tonight. And I'm asking you, with that new mind, that renovated mind, that mind that wants to be as like-minded as Christ, to go ahead and prepare your heart to make an intimate and personal exchange with him tonight. Don't miss this opportunity, because when God does something like this in our midst, it gives us an opportunity to show a measure of gratitude and thanksgiving. And so do that by way of paying your tithe, maybe sow a seed, maybe give an offering tonight, whatever it is you hear him prompting you to do by faith. And on the screen is the various ways by which you can do it. You can do it by way of our website, ecclesiaword.org. You can do it by way of text, Zelle. You can even do it by a phone call. We have someone standing by the phone right now, willing to hear whatever it is you want to say about what God has done, but to also take your offering. And if you want to send in a check, all the information is right there on the screen. But as always, people of God, as you're doing what you feel led to do by the Spirit of God, we do not take for granted that there may have been someone who has stumbled by the grace of God upon this broadcast. God is speaking to you, and the spirit of evangelism is reaching out. And if that is you and you are saying, I want to know him, I want him to take a hold of me, I want you to repeat these words by faith. That means you believe every single word that you are about to release out of your mouth. I want you to say, Father God, I thank you for loving me and for sending Jesus to die for me. Jesus, I believe you are the Son of God and that you died on the cross for my sins. And you rose again on the third day. Jesus, I repent of my sins and I thank you for your forgiveness. I confess and receive you now as my Lord and my Savior. And I thank you for saving me. In Jesus Christ's name. Amen. Hallelujah. We are celebrating with you because you have been engrafted into the kingdom of our Lord Jesus Christ. And even as I said before, it's time for your renovation process. I want you to get connected to a Bible-believing, Bible-teaching church, that word of God that's going to help you transform your life and your mind. And if you're in the New York area, come in, stop by. If you feel that the word of God is impactful, and I know that it is, even by way of streaming, you ain't seen nothing yet until you come into the local house. So if you're in the New York area, stop by 1638 Bronxdale Avenue. We will be happy to receive you. And if you still want to be a part of us, you're saying, I want to be a part of this ministry. I don't know what it is, but I know God. I want you to go ahead and go to our website, ecclesiaword.org. On the first page at the top of the header, we have an area that's called virtual church. Click on it, fill out the information, submit all that we require, and one of us will gladly reach out to you, embrace you, and let you know, hey, welcome to Dream Life. I'm telling you, people of God, God has closed us out with a good word, and I want you to continue to allow that renovation process with him to become more and more progressive. And as you're doing that, thinking about this and saying to yourself, I don't just have the mind of Christ. I'm like-minded. I want you to remember this. You are a reformer and you walk in the anointing of reformation. And it's your faith in God that's changing your circumstances even right now. We love you and we'll see you again with another fiery word on Thursday at 7 o'clock p.m. Love you and see you then.
Thank you for joining Reformers Life Broadcast. We hope you have been blessed and imparted by this teaching, and we look forward to being with you again. To request this teaching in its entirety and for a complete catalog of all of our books, CDs, and DVDs, please visit us at ecclesiaword.org. Remember that you are a reformer, and you walk in the anointing of reformation, and your faith in God is changing your circumstances.